Father, we can have a multitude of possessions. We may have a bulging bank account. But Lord, if we don't have you, we have nothing. Lord, we thank you for your love and your goodness and your kindness to us. And Father, we thank you that we can gather together in your name, that we can sing our praises unto you, Father God. Lord, we thank you that we can open up our Bibles, your word, and that you would speak to us, Father. So we ask that now, Lord. Father, we pray that our sacrifices of worship was pleasing and honoring to you. And Lord, now we ask that you would speak to us out of your word. Father, today would you bring encouragement? Would you bring direction, Lord God? Father, bring help and hope, we pray. For it's in your mighty name we ask it. And together we all would say, amen. You may be seated this morning. Praise the Lord. Thank you, worship team. We're studying the fascinating book of Exodus, and we're up to chapter 4, verse 18. Last couple of weeks, we have been studying and seeing how God and Moses have been having this interaction at the burning bush, and how God says, I've got a plan and a purpose, and I have a destiny for you. I want you to go, and you be my vessel that I'm going to use to deliver the Hebrews out of Egypt's bondage. And as we saw, Moses, like a lot of us, started giving God excuses why that was not a good idea, why he was not the man. And you guys ever argue with God? You ever win? It never works out, does it? Well, Moses is now getting ready to start his road to his destiny. I don't know if it's just from a fortune cookie or where, but you probably heard the saying, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step, right? Well, we're going to see today Moses start that one step. He's going to begin his commission, his commandment, his journey to his destiny. Now, the hardest part of all of this is the first thing he's got to do. He's just had this magnificent encounter with God at the burning bush. Now he's got to tell his wife. Right? You know, that was Gilbert, in case anyone was asking. That was Gilbert. That wasn't Clay. Gilbert also said the men's Bible study video is only 30 minutes, half the time of the women's, because we only needed half as much. But it's all on Gilbert. All on Gilbert. I've got to. Wow, easy. This is a church, you guys. Easy. Love. Brotherhood, all that stuff. Wow. Wow. Bonnie, would you put that graphic up? How many of you can relate to this graphic? On the top is our plans. There's a guy on a straight road heading to the finish line. But on the bottom is God's plan, and it's filled with ups and downs, boulders, bridges, water, all kinds of crazy stuff. Have you guys learned from your own experience that that's usually what it's like? Right? Moses is going to find out that the job that God is giving him isn't going to work out quite in the way that he had it in his mind it was going to work out. And we can learn a lot from that. So if your Bibles are open, if you're with us and don't have a Bible, we have some at the front and the back of the church. We're in Exodus chapter 4, and we made it up to verse 18. So let's read through verse 20. You guys with me? All right, here we go. So Moses went and returned to Jethro, his father-in-law, and said to him, please let me go and return to my brethren who are in Egypt and see whether they are still alive. And Jethro said to Moses, go in peace. He grants his blessing for his son-in-law to go. Now the Lord said to Moses in Midian, go return to Egypt, for all the men who sought your life are now dead. This gives us a little clue in why he was arguing so much not to go. Because remember, when he killed the Egyptian soldier, that was a capital offense. And as long as the Pharaoh was alive, he had a death warrant over him. That Pharaoh is now gone, so his slate is clean. He can now go without fear. Verse 20. Then Moses took his wife and his sons, and he set them on the SUD, that's the sports utility donkey. And he returned to the land of Egypt. Underline this word. And Moses took the rod of God in his hand. Always remember this, friends, that whenever God takes us out of a situation, whenever God moves us, he takes us out in order to take us in to something. And God's plans are always greater, right? So he takes us out to move us in. So now Moses, he's told his wife, there's a great, you know, there's a lot of great movies about the Exodus, and there's a lot of bad ones too. But how many of you remember the cartoon one that Disney put out a few years ago, The Prince of Egypt? In that cartoon version of the Exodus, it's the only movie that I've seen, and I watch a lot of cartoons, but it's the only movie that I've seen that addressed Moses telling Zipporah, Now, it doesn't record the dialogue. There's a song going, and instead of the song being Let It Go, it's Let Us Go. I didn't think it'd go over well, but anyway, it shows a silhouette of Moses leaving the burning bush, going home, and telling his wife, and she's kind of like startled with all this. This was a crazy idea. But here's the point. The point is that we need the support and encouragement of our family. Now, you guys know that I tease my wife a lot, but I have to be very honest with you guys. I am so fortunate for my family, because give her a hand clap. Yeah. When I started my journey, I was in another profession, and we were adults. We had kids and a mortgage and all this kind of stuff, and I felt God was calling me to ministry. And fortunately, I had the support of my wife and children. We're going to see here that Moses, in just a few verses, his wife and kids, it doesn't go real well. And I went to Bible school with a couple of people that they did not have the support of family. And it was very hard. It was very, very tough. And we need to be supportive of people who have a call of God on their life, you know. And we also have to be very careful that we do not become enablers of people who have a call of Satan on their life. That makes sense? You know, a lot of people will enable someone to sin, but won't encourage to follow God. That's a whole other sermon series that we won't get into. But here, the importance of the family. Notice that verse 20, here we see, I had you underline it, he took the rod of God in his hand. The key to victory there for Moses and for us here today is to make sure that we have the power of God with us. In the Bible, we learn the three things. We can call them the three staffs or three rods of God that God has given us. He's given us the Holy Spirit. Jesus said you will be endued with power from the Holy Spirit when he comes upon you. Remember that? That's recorded in the book of Acts. Also, the Word of God, the Bible, is powerful. It is powerful. It is quick. It is sharp, right? You can take that off of the thing, Bonnie. And then also we have the name of Jesus, or the authority in Jesus' name. Jesus said, anything you ask in my name, you shall have, right? So we too have symbolically our staff of God. And we need to make sure that we always have that and we use the blessings that God has given us. Now, verse 21, it says, and the Lord said to Moses, when you go back to Egypt, see that you do all these wonders before Pharaoh, which I have put in your hand, but I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. And we need to stop here and just take a couple of minutes, because this verse freaks a lot of people out, especially anti-God, anti-Bible people. They say, see, God is just setting poor Pharaoh up for failure, and God's a mean, cruel God and all that. Well, let's look at it here, because we know that that's not true, right? Go back and look at chapter 3, verse 19. God is talking to Moses, and he says this. He says, but I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, not even by a mighty hand. So what God is saying here is he's simply saying, Pharaoh has made his mind up to not allow you to do this. That word harden, where God says, I will harden his heart, it means to make strong the will, to make strong the will. The original Hebrew of that verse says, God says, I will make strong the will of his heart. Look in your Bibles, we're in chapter 4. Go to chapter 8 real quick. Let's look at verse 15. You guys there? Verse 15. When Pharaoh saw that there was relief, he hardened his heart, and he did not heed them as the Lord said. Now drop down to verse 32, same chapter, chapter 8, verse 32. But Pharaoh hardened his heart at this time. Okay? We can go back to our text. I just want to tell you this. 10 times in this whole 10 plague thing, 10 times we're going to see where the Bible specifically says God hardened Pharaoh's heart. 10 times we will see that God says Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And what happens is we will see that up until the 5th plague, Pharaoh is hardening his own heart. After the 5th plague, God hardens his heart. And what he's doing is, God is just simply reinforcing what he has already determined to do. Right? He's just reinforcing what he's determined to do. This is a divine principle that applies to all the unrepentant. If a person persists in rebellion against God and God's word, God will let their heart grow hard. Further overhead, please, Romans 1, 24 and verse 28. These are some scary scriptures here. I have a lot of people ask me, especially with the election, all this stuff, they're very curious about the Ezekiel 37-38 war and Gog and Magog and all stuff. They're asking about Russia and prophecy and stuff, which I dig all that stuff. But can I just be honest with you? The most incredible prophecy scripture is not in Revelation or Ezekiel or any of those. It's right here in Romans chapter 1. Because in Romans chapter 1, it tells us the evolution of mankind and his heart and his behavior and the culture. Look at a couple of scriptures. Verse 24 of Romans 1. Therefore God also gave them up to uncleanness and the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves. People got to a point where God says, okay. In verse 28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, you know, the world today does it. We don't need God. It's a waste of time and all that stuff. God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting. They persisted in sin. They're persisting in perversion. They're persisting in doing all this. There comes a point where God says, have it your way. Right? Kind of a scary thought. Right? Well, let's go back to our text here in Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. Then you shall say to Pharaoh, thus says the Lord, Israel is my son, my firstborn. So I say to you, let my son, Israel, go that he may serve me. But if you refuse to let him go, indeed I will kill your son, your firstborn. That, of course, will be the tenth plague. And it's a very, very scary situation. Now, in verse 24 through 26, we see an encounter between God and Moses that causes more questions than answers. Let's read this. This is very interesting. They're difficult verses, but important verses. Verse 24. And it came to pass on the way at the encampment that the Lord met him, this being Moses, and sought to kill him. Then Zipporah took a sharp stone and cut off the foreskin of her son and cast it at Moses' feet and said, surely you are a husband of blood to me. So he, God, let him, Moses, go. The actual word there is God healed him. Then she said, Zipporah saying to Moses, you are a husband of blood because of the circumcision. Man, that's some crazy three verses there, right? Now, what is going on? God has just spent 80 years grooming this guy, Moses, to do this job. God is just was so patient with Moses at the burning bush, bringing him to the point where he finally says, okay, I will do this. And now God stops him on the way and is going to strike him dead. Now, I wish this would have been expanded a little bit, but we do learn a couple things here. We do know that living in Midian, Zipporah and her family, not being Hebrews, would not be a part of the Jewish customs that would be performed. But notice a couple things. She knew what had to be done and what was required. Now, we don't have any... Remember, God didn't appear to her at the burning bush. She's following her husband. But she knows what has to be done and what's required. She knew that she had to use a flint stone. Not like Fred Flintstone, but a stone of flint. That's what they'd use for knives. Man would use knives, and God would require him to use stone. Why? Well, remember, everything in the Bible, there's a reason. Stones are God-made. Knives are man-made. Okay? We will see when Joshua circumcises the nation of Israel, he has to use a stone. He can't use a knife. They had knives, but they couldn't use it because God created this covenant, and he did all the work, right? So she knew that circumcision was the seal or the evidence of this covenant with God. She knew that it also served as a sign that as the people of God, they were not to put confidence in the flesh, but their confidence was to be in God. Also, would you notice that she uses the word, and the Bible uses the word son singular. And we know that they had two sons. Now, could it be, I'm not saying this is what happened, I'm just saying this Clay's thought, and sometimes Clay's thoughts aren't right. But could it be that when the firstborn Gershom was born and Moses circumcised him on the eighth day, that Mama Z just freaked out doing this to my little boy? And so when Eliezer, the second son, come along, she says, you ain't doing that again. I mean, that's a possibility. We don't know for sure, but it's interesting that she only had to circumcise one of the two, right? Well, I've got, now don't let this number freak you out, I've got 9 observations from this interesting and troubling event. I know, 3 verses, 9 observations. I'm just going to read them real quick. Well, a couple I'm going to read quick, a couple I won't. But we can learn some things here, okay? The first observation that I see here, and a principle we can apply to us, is number one, that even outside of the church building, even on days other than Sundays, we're still to be Christians. He was not in Goshen with the Hebrews. He was not living among his people. He was living among pagans in a pagan land that worshiped pagan gods and stuff. But that did not stop God from requiring him to keep the laws, right? And friends, if your Christianity only lasts and is only in effect when you're inside these walls, you don't have Christianity. You've got a religion, right? So the second observation is we must be careful that we don't let those around us diminish our dedication to the things of God. Okay, let me read that again. We must be careful that we don't let the people around us diminish our dedication for the things of God. Zipporah and her family, again, were not Hebrews. And so instead of bringing his children up in the ways of the Hebrews, Moses brought them up in the ways of the Midianites. You know? What does that mean to us? Well, have you ever been in a situation where maybe you and a group of people go into a restaurant or something, and or you're at some place where there's food and everyone just starts eating and you haven't prayed yet? Now, this doesn't mean you stand up and slam your fist down and say, "Thus saith the Lord, you know, bless these taters," or whatever, you know. You know. But you can bow your head and thank the Lord before you eat, you know. Don't let those around you influence you to diminish your dedication to God. Now, notice this here. Well, third point, then I'll read this. My third observation is obedience to God's word may bring hardship in the home, the office, the classroom. Our obedience to God's word may bring hardships in the home, the office, or the classroom. Zipporah's resentment is very obvious in the words that she said, "You are a husband of blood to me." Can you feel the love in that statement? Right. Now, I wrote this down. Let me read it as I wrote it down. By not circumcising his son, Moses brought peace to his house, but he did not bring peace with God. By not circumcising his son, Moses brought peace to his house, but not peace with God. You know, if you're not right with God, nothing else will end up right. The fourth thing we see here is that the shedding of blood is offensive. The cross is offensive. People don't understand why Jesus had to be nailed to the cross, why blood had to be spilled. Well, I gave you scripture last week in Leviticus, the life of the flesh is in the blood, and the blood had to be spilled in order for you and I to be saved. Jesus is offensive to people today. And I don't care if it offends you, you still need him. Right? Fifth observation, we see that if you want to be an effective witness for Christ, we all have to have our own life right with God. Before you can start leading other people out of Egypt into the promised land, you need to make sure you're right with God. Have you ever noticed it's always easier to correct somebody else than to correct yourself? Right? You know? Number 6. This was kind of deep. We can forfeit our opportunities to serve God. We can forfeit our opportunities to serve God. By disobedience in one area, Moses almost lost 80 years of preparation and the amazing job of being God's deliverer of Egypt. Paul said some interesting words. He said, you know, "I take caution unless I too shall become disqualified." Whoa. That's interesting, huh? The seventh thing, I told you I was going through these pretty quick. The seventh thing is the more fruit-bearing qualities we possess, the more thoroughly we shall be pruned. The more fruit-bearing opportunities we possess, the more thoroughly we shall be pruned. With our growth and our maturity, in the Lord comes responsibility. Right? Wednesday night, in our Wednesday night Bible study in 1 Corinthians, we kind of covered this thing here where Paul's saying, you know, for the sake of the brethren, I watch my diet. He says, you know, if what I eat offends somebody, I won't eat that for their sake. But we have responsibilities. We have freedoms. We have liberty, but we also have responsibilities, right? So the more fruit-bearing qualities we possess, the more thoroughly we will be pruned. Number eight, remember, I only got nine, so this is cool. Number eight, secret or hidden sins will come out into the open sooner or later. The fact that Moses' son was not circumcised could not be seen by men, but it was seen by God. For the overhead, please, Ecclesiastes 12:14 tells us, for God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. If you're taking notes, we won't turn to there or read them, but Luke 12:2, Jesus says basically the same thing. 1 Corinthians 4:5, Paul says the same thing. So in other words, hidden or secret sins will come out eventually. Number nine, and finally, and then we'll move on. Number nine, God lets us get right with him and continue moving forward. Thank God that God forgives and God restores and God gives second chances, right? I mean, how many times have we maybe not even realized that we've experienced the mercy of God and didn't even know it? And so God gave him the opportunity to make this right and then to continue on with this job. One of the things that we will learn here, it says God healed Moses, but Zipporah was not a happy camper. Would you agree? In fact, we find out from this point on, she takes the boys and she goes home to daddy. And hold your spot there, but go to chapter 18 real quick, Exodus 18. They will be reunited, but just very briefly. You guys there? Let's read verses 2 and 3. Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her back with her two sons, of whom the name of one was Gershom. I'm thinking Gershom was, that second one is the reason they name him there is because the whole circumcision deal. But I don't know. Anyway, they go back to meet after the plagues and after they're out and all that stuff. But even that doesn't last, and we find that she leaves again. And in fact, in a few years, we'll find that Moses will marry a second time to another lady. So count the cost. Count the cost. Chapter 5, I'm sorry, verse 27. And the Lord said to Aaron, go into the wilderness to meet Moses. So he went and he met him on the mountain of God, and he kissed him. And Moses told Aaron all the words of the Lord who had sent him and all the signs which he had commanded him. Then Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the children of Israel. And Aaron spoke all the words which the Lord had spoken to Moses. And he did the signs in the sight of the people. So the people believed, and when they had heard that the Lord had visited the children of Israel and that he had looked on their afflictions, then they bowed their heads and they worshiped. Moses' big argument to God was, what if the people don't believe me? Well, we find out they believe him. They accept him. And they return to worshiping God. Now, everything is rosy and cheery now, right? Now, things are really going to get twisted. Let's look at chapter 5. And by all the power in me, I'm going to read the whole chapter without stopping. I can do this. I can do this. I can do this. You guys with me? Chapter 5, verse 1. Afterwards, Moses and Aaron went in and told Pharaoh, thus says the Lord God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness. And Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey his voice and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord, nor will I let Israel go. So they said, the God of the Hebrews have met with us. Please let us go 3 days' journey into the desert and sacrifice to the Lord our God, lest he fall upon us with pestilence or with the sword. And then the king of Egypt said to them, Moses and Aaron, why do you take the people from their work? Get back to your labor. And Pharaoh said, look, the people of the land, they are many now, and you make them rest from their labor. So the same day Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people and their officers, saying, you shall no longer give the people straw to make brick as before. Let let them go and gather straw for themselves. And you shall lay on them the quota of brick which they made before. You shall not reduce it, for they are idle. Therefore they cry out, saying, let us go and sacrifice to our God. Let more work be laid on the men, that they may labor in it, and let them not regard false, your Bible may say vain words. And the taskmasters of the people and their officers went out and spoke to the people, saying, thus says Pharaoh, I will not give you straw. Go get yourself straw where you can find it, yet none of your work will be reduced. So the people were scattered abroad throughout all the land of Egypt to gather stubble instead of straw. And the taskmasters forced them to hurry, saying, fulfill your work, your daily quota, as when there was straw. Also the officers of the children of Israel, whom Pharaoh's taskmasters had set over them, were beaten and were asked, why have you not fulfilled your task in making brick both yesterday and today as before? Then the officers of the children of Israel came and cried out to Pharaoh, saying, why are you dealing with your thus with your servants? There is no straw given to us, to your servants. And then they say to us, make brick? And indeed your servants are beaten, but the fault is in your own people. But he said, you are idle, idle. Therefore you say, let us go and sacrifice to the Lord. Therefore go now and work, for no straw shall be given to you, yet you shall deliver the quota of brick. And the officers of the children of Israel saw that they were in trouble after it, and said, you shall not reduce any bricks from your daily quota. Then as they came out from Pharaoh, they met Moses and Aaron, who stood there to meet them. And they said to them, let the Lord look on you and judge, because you have made us an abhorrent in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to kill us. So Moses returned to the Lord and said, Lord, why have you brought trouble on this people? Why is it that you have sent me? For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done evil to this people, neither have you delivered your people at all. I made the whole chapter. Wow. I'm never doing that again. That was hard. Couple things here in going back, and then we're going to make application to our lives here. If you'll notice in verse 5:1, chapter 5, verse 1, when Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh, our Bible says they said the Lord God of Israel. They actually spoke the name Jehovah Elohim. There were a lot of gods in Egypt. In fact, Pharaoh was considered a god, right? So they said Jehovah Elohim says, let my people go. Now, having a full gospel background, we would always stop at the let my people go. Man, we would start rebuking demons and hooting, hollering, and slobbering and spitting and you doing all that holy roller stuff, and we forgot the most important part. Why are we to let the people go? That they may worship me in the wilderness. You see, a lot of people want to be let go. They want to be freed from a bondage, but not to serve God, but to serve themselves. Right? To serve the God of selfishness, or the God of greed. And a lot of people make deals with God. God, you just get me through this, and I'll do anything you ask. I'll go anywhere you ask. God will free you from that, and you go back into the old stuff. Right? God, free me from this bondage of debt. God does a great miracle, and we get ourselves back in trouble. God, deliver me from this habit that I'm looking at Mark, so I'll just say Copenhagen. Right? It could be anything, and it doesn't have to be bad, but sorry, Mark. I mean, that's what you get when you sit in the front, man. You get, you know. But we've all done that, right? We've struggled with. I'm not saying Mark got problems. I'm just. But he is coming to the men's thing tonight. So. Anyway, you guys know what I'm getting at, right? A lot of us cry out to God, God, let me free. God, give me freedom. But it's not for the right reasons, right? They say, let my people go that we may hold a feast in the wilderness. And so now Pharaoh says, well, who is this Jehovah dude? I know about 3,000 gods, but I don't know that one. Why should I listen to him? He can't even take care of his own people. Right? Okay, again, being real serious with you. You ever try to witness and bring encouragement to somebody, but yet you're not living your life right with God? And so they'll throw this in your face. Don't tell them about this God stuff. You can't even deal with that yourself. That's basically what Pharaoh was saying. He ain't much of a God if you are my people, you're not his people. I give the commandments, not this Jehovah guy. Now, I love this in verse 3. It didn't work, so Moses goes, please? Please let us go in the desert? Turn to chapter 8, verse 25. Notice Moses said, we need to go out in the wilderness to do this. Okay, I'm sorry, 1st chapter 7, verse 5. I gave you the wrong chapter. Exodus 7, verse 5 says, and the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I stretch out my hand on Egypt and bring out the children of Israel from among them. Pharaoh said, who is God? God says, buddy, you're going to know who I am. By the time I'm done with you, there'll be no doubt, right? Now turn to chapter 8. Verse 25 and 26. Then Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron and said, go sacrifice to the God, to your God in the land. And Moses said, it is not right to do so, for we would sacrificing the abomination of the Egyptians to the Lord our God. If we sacrifice the abomination of the Egyptians before their eyes, then will they not stone us? The reason Moses said we need to go 3 days out in the wilderness to do this is because what they were going to do, their sacrifices and stuff, would be offensive to the Egyptians. They worship these cows, kind of like in, is it India? People are starving and cows are walking around the streets. I'll tell you what, that's why I don't go to India, because I would get thrown in jail or something. As I've said before, I'm a vegetarian. It's the worst nightmare. But he's saying, we've got to get out of here, because if we worship God here, it'll offend the people. Notice a couple things here. Number one, worshiping Jesus often offends people. What the Egyptians considered a sacrifice, what the Hebrews considered a sacrifice, the world considers sacred. How many people tell you, why would you go to that place on Sunday? Why would you get up early to go to church? That's your only day to sleep in, right? Because what the world considers sacred, we sacrifice to our God. The second thing we see here is that when we worship, we are to be separated from Egypt or the world, right? See, there's a dangerous trend in the churches today to not offend. So, now, that doesn't give us permission to be, snooty or rude or anything like that. We're not to be offensive to people. But what the modern church trend is to bring Egypt into the church instead of taking the church out of Egypt, right? See, the world is based upon, they play to the senses, to our feelings and to our emotions to get a reaction. But true worship of God, true worship through the Holy Spirit deals with the human heart. And it's when we deal with the human hearts, that's when things start happening, right? And that's why be very, very careful if a church is advertise. If the reason you go to church is for donuts, you're going to church for the wrong reason. Nothing wrong with donuts, as you can tell. I am a fan. But you guys see what I'm saying? So he said, we've got to get out of the land in order to sacrifice to God. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever made a stand for God and everything blows up? Write this down. Here's a spiritual principle, spiritual truth. When we make a stand for God, Satan tightens his grip before he will loosen his hold on somebody. Let me say that again. When we make a stand for God, Satan will tighten his grip before he loosens his hold on somebody. Great example, great truth of this. And I find it mostly with ladies. That is, they're having trouble with their fellas. And I tell them, pray for your man and do this and blah, blah, blah. And they'll come back mad at me because instead of getting better, he's just gotten to be more of a rascal. Well, that usually is how it'll work. Satan will tighten that grasp in a last attempt before he's got to free you, right? So don't let that disappoint you or influence you to stop trying. Also notice that the world, what Pharaoh did here, is he stopped providing them with straw. Straw was not grown in Egypt. It was trucked in. And it was made available to them. They were working hard, but at least they had the supplies there, right? So now they've got to go out and get straw. Well, it says here, as we read, instead of straw, they got stubble. You ever feel like in your life it's more stubble than straw? Right? And with stubble in the brick, it makes it weaker. It crumbles easier. And friends, if we're building our life and our spiritual position on stubble and mud, it will crumble. Does that make sense? You kind of see the picture I'm painting here? We need to have that straw, so to speak. And they took it away from them. And so they still have to make their daily quota. Here's my second point, that when a person is rejecting God and God's message, they do irrational stuff. It was stupid of Pharaoh to, all it did was hurt him. I mean, yeah, it hurt the Hebrews, but now he can't build Egypt, and that's what he wants to do. But when we're living in sin and rejecting God, we usually make some irrational decisions and stuff. We see this in today's world. We'll see that, and it's usually if a wife gets saved or decides she's going to start going to church, usually the husband will start putting some more demands on her to not make it available for her to go to church, right? Your teenager gets right with God and starts wanting to go to this youth group. And as crazy as it sounds, a parent will start giving them more chores and do stuff to do so that they can't go to youth group. Now, there's nothing wrong with doing chores. But friends, your child is better off having a relationship with God than your lawn being mowed. Right? You go mow the lawn so your kid can go to youth group. Verse 9, Pharaoh says, "Let the work be laid on them, and let them not regard false words," or your Bible might say vain words. Pharaoh refers to Moses' request to worship as vain or a waste of time, as empty. This mentality still prevails today. People think going to church is a waste of time, that it's a vain thing, right? So that mindset is still around today. Verses 10 through 13, the straw, we just read that was about the straw. Here's my point, verse 13. Again, putting unreasonable demands on God's people to disprove God. Our world, you guys see the God's Not Dead movies? Aren't they good movies? I like the second one better than the first one, but anyway, they're good. And it was a picture of this. The world is doing all it can to disprove the existence of God to their own hurt. Right? And so they're putting unreasonable demands on God's people. And we will be challenged in our spiritual walk by the world. We'll be challenged, right? Now, verse 15, I'm almost done here. Verse 15 says, "And the officers of the children of Israel came and cried out to Pharaoh." What was their mistake there? They should have cried out to God. For the overhead, please, Isaiah 31. Isaiah 31 says, "Woe to the rebellious children, says the Lord, who take counsel, but not of me, and who devise plans, but not of my spirit, that they may add sin to sin." Things start getting a little bit rough, and they cry out to Pharaoh instead of to God. We need to be careful. We don't get our attention on the government and not on God. Right? Speaking to anybody here? Now, also, we see a thing that happens is all this is going on and they come out of the meeting and Moses and Aaron are standing there. Verse 21, and they said, "Let the Lord look on you and judge, because you have made us abhorrent in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servant, to put a sword to us and to kill us." You know, first person you get mad at is the preacher, because what you said didn't work. I've had more cruel things and mean things said about me and to me. And let me just tell you guys something. I'm not a mind reader. I get scolded for not addressing a situation that I had no idea was going on. right? I'm not a mind reader. But they get mad at Moses. Chapter before, they're worshiping God and they're all excited. Satan puts up the pressure a little bit. Well, now they're going to lynch the preacher. So Moses is now feeling rejected. Now, up to this point, we've seen Moses has been rejected by his wife. We see he's been rejected by Pharaoh. And now he's being rejected by the people. You ever feel like that? That everyone's turning against you? Rejection hurts, especially when it's people that you love that rejects you. And friends, listen to me right now. If you got nothing else from today's lesson, please know this. God will never reject you. The world will. The world will turn its back on you. But God will never reject you. He sent his son Jesus to Calvary's cross for you. He will never leave you, forsake you, or reject you. Moses obviously asks in this verse 22, two times he asks, why? You know, why did you bring trouble on the people and why did you send me? Once again, that picture of our plan versus God's plan, right? We don't always understand the plans of God, but we can trust God. We can trust God. And so, in conclusion, a couple of things here. Moses was expecting faster results and fewer problems, but that isn't always God's way. Moses is disappointed, rejected, and confused about what God is doing. I think all of us can relate to that. Through times of disappointment, the believer must continue to walk by faith in God and his word, trusting God to work out his will in his own time. When Pharaoh said, "Who is the Lord that I should obey him?" How I want to end today is I want to ask you, do you know who the Lord is that you may obey him? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God who died on Calvary's cross, so that you may obey him? Jesus loves you so much that he did come to this planet to die for you. Sometimes in our journey to destiny, it doesn't go smooth. Sometimes there's crevices and stops and turns and all that kind of stuff, right? Like our little graph showed. But friends, you can be assured of this. God has got a destiny for you, and he will bring you to it if you will allow him. Don't let the world catch you by surprise. Don't let the world discourage you, and don't let Satan cause you to give up. You hold on to God. When everyone else splits, you stick so tight to God, right? Because with every Egypt, there comes a deliverance, right? Now, don't you know, I mean, it's funner to picture ourselves holding that staff, walking through walls of water, than it is to picture ourselves holding that staff, getting beat up by the people and by Moses, right? But you don't get to walk through the water without beginning the journey. That makes sense? Cool. Let's stand and pray. Worship team, join me up here. Well, did you guys learn anything today? Isn't this just a fascinating study? I love the book of Exodus. And as we start getting into the signs and the plagues and stuff, it's just awesome what happens here. Our God is so magnificent. Nothing he can't handle. Well, if you're visiting with us, this might be a little bit different church experience than what you're used to. What's happening now is worship team's going to come up here and they're just going to play a worship song. And while they're doing that, we open up the altars for prayer. And we invite you that if you have a need, if God is dealing with you on something, and if you need prayer, we invite you to come forward, and we want to pray with you and for you. And then after that's done, and it usually only lasts about the length of a song. Of course, we never want to hinder or stop what the Holy Spirit's doing. But in our plan, usually after that song is done, we will have a congregational dismissal prayer. Now, if you're not coming forward to prayer, we do ask that you remain in an attitude of worship where you are, and let's be considerate of those who are praying and let the Holy Spirit do what he wants to do here, okay? So let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word, and Lord, thank you for encouragement. Father, there's things that happen in our life that we don't understand. They can be very painful and very unpleasant. Father, we can feel abandoned by people. And Father, admittedly, we sometimes feel disappointed and abandoned by you. But Father, we know that we can trust you. We know that we are to seek you and not seek man. Father, we know that as Jesus taught us, that we are securely in your hand and no one can snatch us out of that. But Lord, they can sure toss the boulders our way. So Lord, would you help us to remain faithful and true to the calling that you've given us? Father, I ask that today, if there's anyone here who needs to be released and let go, Lord, I pray that today they would find that freedom. But let us not forget the reason that you give us healing, the reason you give us freedom, the reason you give us deliverance is so that we might worship you. So Lord, I pray that you'd help us to examine ourselves. Would you help us examine the motives of our own heart, Lord God? And then Father, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you'd continue to teach every one of us as we review these things that happen. Would you bring out even more lessons, more personal truths, and apply it to our lives, Father? And then Lord, as always, we'll be very quick and careful to give you all the praise and the glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship God.